Does this microphone work? Yes, it does. Welcome to our Q&A. Thank you very much. Great to see you all here. A big crowd, and I'm guessing that some of you are still waiting for the Friday night bus. Seriously, that was the biggest refugee crisis on the North Coast since Pauline Hanson announced she was going to come and live in Byron. Just kidding. Now, no need to run away yet. I think she's still in Ipswich. Now, we live in very strange times. I've got a few words before I introduce the panel, so pay attention because some of these themes are likely to come up in the Q&A. I know what you guys are like, so I know that many of you have questions. We've got some roving microphones. We have a few people who've submitted questions in advance. We thank you for that. We'll come to some of those, but really, this is a chance for you to get involved spontaneously, so if you've got questions, just get ready to put up your hands. So I would say this as a starting point. We live, all of us, in very strange times. Now, many of us, probably many of you, were in this tent. I certainly was a year ago. And I don't think any of us would have believed, for example, that Pauline Hanson and her One Nation party would be poised to win somewhere between 4 and 6 senators to join her war on everything. And if you told me that Donald Trump, we'll save your shames for later, if you told me that Donald Trump would be within reach of the US presidency, that Britain would have seceded from Europe, that Boris Johnson, the former slightly crazy mayor of London, would be the foreign secretary, I'd have said, no, you're dreaming. But of course, all of this, like some of the wilder predictions of Nostradamus, has actually come to pass. Now, I'm not saying that we have reached a kind of end of days scenario, but they are very strange days. So welcome to the Strange Days Q&A. Now, after the weirdest presidential nomination speech that anyone that I know can remember, Donald Trump is now neck and neck with Hillary Clinton, who he referred to in his speech as a criminal, whose legacy, he says, is death, destruction, terrorism, and weakness. 24 hours ago, an 18-year-old German-Iranian was gunning down fellow teenagers in the streets of Munich because he'd been bullied as a kid. Many of them were inside a McDonald's store. A lot of people jumped at the conclusion that he was an Islamic jihadist, but it seems he was actually inspired by two white Americans who did the Columbine school massacre. Just over a week ago, a mentally ill French Moroccan plowed his truck into a crowd of families who'd just been watching fireworks on the shorefront in Nice. Was he a jihadist? We don't really know the answer to that. Was he just plain crazy? Who knows? But the world is on edge. There's no question we are vulnerable at the moment. Not only to terrorism, but we are vulnerable to demagoguery. Putin in Russia, Trump in the United States, and here in Australia we've got Pauline Hanson, who says that people live in fear of terrorism and of Islamic migration. 500,000 people voted in Australia for One Nation, so maybe that fear is a very potent force. Meanwhile, Barack Obama, the president who promoted hope, not fear, has been responsible for instituting, as one of our guests here will tell us today, a widespread program of drone warfare aimed at terrorism that, as Sean Westmoreland, sitting to my right, says, has actually made terrorism worse. They say, and a group of other people who've come from within the drone warfare program say, it is fueling feelings of hatred that have ignited terrorism and groups like ISIS. Now, just to give you a bit of a kind of heads up as to where Sean once worked in the drone warfare program in Kandahar in Afghanistan, just next door to their headquarters was a Google office. Google, of course, as many of you would know, use your metadata to target your consumer choices, while the drone program uses the same metadata to target terrorists. We live in very strange times. Here in Australia, we've just had the longest election campaign in modern history. Maybe we'll have another national vote very soon on same-sex marriage. The three politicians who survived that long campaign are on our panel today to answer your questions. I'll quickly introduce them. They are Green Senator Sarah Hanson-Young. Obviously, many of you know she's from South Australia, and many of you know a lot about Senator Hanson-Young, so I won't tell you too much about her. To my left here is Labor MP and former industrial lawyer Teri Butler, who holds the seat of Griffiths in Brisbane. Now, Teri, overnight or in the past 24 hours, has been made the Shadow Assistant Minister for Child Safety and Family Violence for universities. She says she's part of a Labor dream team on education and equality. Save it. And equality. The key focus of the equality section is the LGBTI community. So on my right over here is LNP MP Andrew Lamming from Redland City and North Stradley, which is actually Stradbroke. North Stradley, anyway. Who, among other things, spent time in Kabul, Afghanistan, strangely enough, at exactly the same time that I did. Back in the early 1990s, he was doing battlefield surgery. You may know him better for standing on his head on Australia Day and sculling a pint of beer. However, he's a unique politician in the sense that I think he could go anywhere at any time and feels unconstrained, I think, from doing that. Now, to my left over here, many of you will know Peter Greste. He's a distinguished Australian journalist. Okay, save your applause, because I'll give you a chance to applaud everybody in a moment. So a distinguished Australian journalist and foreign correspondent who, while working in Cairo for Al Jazeera, was locked up by the Egyptian government for daring to report on the Muslim Brotherhood, who had just been deposed from government in 2013 in a military coup. And our final panellist, I mentioned him earlier, is Sean Westmoreland. Now, Sean was a former US Air Force technician who was responsible, at least partly responsible, for building the complex communications infrastructure of the drone warfare program in Kandahar, Afghanistan, in the 73rd Expeditionary Squadron of the US Air Force. He and among a number of other people, as I've just mentioned, from inside the drone program, have now come out to say that it is actually very dangerous and it is killing a lot of civilians. Please welcome our panel. Thank you very much. Now, I can't see you so well because we've somehow lost the lights on you, so if we can get those back, it'd be great so I can see your hands up. But our first question, we do have one submitted to us. That's better. Thank you very much. Our first question is from Peter Fitzgerald. And the rest of you get ready and throw your hands up when you want to get involved in the discussion. We'll start with Peter.
Okay. Thanks, Tony. To the panel, we've seen the rise of the isolationist politicians like Donald Trump and Pauline Hanson. And the British people have now voted to exit the European community. Is it the beginning of a new era of rejection of globalisation? Or is it racism? Or is it just something else, a desire for more sovereignty?
Peter, can I start with you, fellow journalist?
I think it's a very, very, very worrying trend. There are all sorts of... It's a very simple question, but I think it's got a lot of very complex answers behind it. We are seeing a backlash, not necessarily against globalisation, but I think of the consequences of what people perceive to be globalisation. Growing inequality, the refugee crisis and so on. Obviously, the war on terror is also fueling that. But I also think that the echo chambers of the internet, Twitter, Facebook and so on, I think is also creating or allowing the extremes, the extremist views on the fringes of politics to inflate themselves, to become more and more enhanced and to gain some political legitimacy that I think in pre-internet days, in pre-Facebook and Twitter days, we wouldn't have seen. So I think that that's actually giving a lot of credibility to those on the fringes of politics and creating really quite radically extreme political movements that I think just wouldn't have had traction in the past.
Let's go right to the other end of the panel here from Sarah Hanson-Young, and you'll be actually sharing a chamber with Pauline Hanson and possibly four of her senators, maybe five of her senators. How's that going to be, and what do you think has fueled the rise of Pauline Hanson?
Firstly, let me just say, we're not related, Pauline and I. Apparently, there's some rumours on the internet that that's the echo chamber of the internet, that somehow she's my long-lost mother. I'm wondering whether when she gets really ranty in the chamber sometime, I'm just going to stand up and say, "Mum, you're embarrassing me." I might just We'll see. I've never actually met her, so it's going to be interesting in the chamber as to how we deal with these issues. But to the crux of the question, I think it is more than just one of those options, but I think the issue of inequality is absolutely there. The issue of racism is there, but what I find disturbing about Pauline Hanson's approach is that she is a racist, her views are racist, and she blames people of other cultures, of other backgrounds, of other religions for the broader problems of inequality that we have here in the Australian community and elsewhere. And it's, in fact, doing the exact opposite for the people who have voted for her, because you won't fix unemployment and you won't fix the state of the country roads and you won't fix public transport or the housing crisis by simply saying Muslims can't come to this country. It's a false solution that she's selling, and all she's doing is peddling racism while feeding into the issues of inequality that need to be tackled. And while it continues to be sold as a racist issue or an issue of religion or an issue of people coming from other countries, of immigration, it lets the government and successive governments off the hook from investing in essential services and infrastructure. And that's what we have to avoid. We have to actually have that discussion and not let immigration be the scapegoat.
All right, let's go a bit broader. Andrew, thank you very much. Andrew mentioned there Trump, Brexit, Hanson. There are similarities in the forces that brought all of these people to the forefront in different countries. What do you think?
Well, it's, Tony, driven by fear. I mean, Sarah's spot on. We have elections based on fear and then others on optimism. At the moment, middle-class America has seen a wipeout of well-paid jobs replaced by just as many jobs on the poverty line. That makes people frightened. When you do, you have solo flights with minor players and extreme voices. So 23% of Australians are doing just that. I don't blame them. They should shake up the major parties, and I include all three parties in that. If you're just going to sit around, be complacent and settle for what we've got at the moment, then you can guarantee get more of the same. So for those that aren't voting for three major parties, you can't get a stronger lesson.
So, Andrew, are you saying this is not the most exciting time to be in Australia?
As long as you're agile and nimble, it is.
Okay, let's hear from our other politician, Teri. While we're doing that, I've got a question from Broden Kelly. If we can get Broden to identify himself, get a microphone. Broden's over here. Get a microphone to Broden, but we'll just let Teri answer first. Thank you.
Thank you, Tony. Hi, everyone. Look, I think this is a really important question, because since the Second World War, for the decades since that war, life was getting better. I mean, life was tough, right? But we could see that every generation was experiencing an improvement on living standards. Life was getting better. But since the 90s, I think life hasn't been getting better. Life has actually been getting harder. The world's seemed to have got maybe less safe, but what's really being experienced is actually an increase in inequality. So people in the middle are not experiencing the growth in living standards. And in fact, what's happening in the US and a lot of Western countries is that living standards are actually going backwards. So when people talk about inequality and the effects of globalisation, it's the real lived experience that a lot of you are having compared to what I have. I mean, my parents, when they were 20, they bought a house. My dad was working in a mailroom and my mum was working in her dad's business. They bought a house. In my age, we had to wait till our 30s. A lot of people in this room, you can't afford a house. Like, it's just a dream to think that you can get the deposit, get the loan, get a house. And so the fact is things are actually getting tougher and we're not alone in that. And I think people are looking around and saying, we want some simple answers. And for me, I feel like saying, well, actually, things aren't that simple. And people who are looking for simple answers, you're not going to find them. And in fact, what we need to do is we need to fix the way that economies and societies work so that things can get better. And that actually means taking an interest in some of the tough questions and some of the really hard questions of politics and economics.
But doesn't that cut to the core of the question, which was, why are we seeing the shift to the extremes? And we're blaming the outsiders, we're using the politics of fear. We're blaming, it's easy to, I mean, it's a classic demagogue's strategy it's exactly what Hitler did. You find a scapegoat, you blame them, you blame all of your problems on the outsiders. And why are we not seeing politicians accepting a certain degree of responsibility for fixing these things.
Peter, I'm just going to jump in, and I mean, we were talking about Donald Trump, and then you've raised the question of Hitler. I'm just putting it to you. Are you seeing any comparisons there?
Gosh, this is on the record, isn't it? Look, if you let's abstract it out. What you have is Hitler, who was using populism. He was using fear of the other. He was demonizing and scapegoating the Jewish community. He was promising quick and easy solutions. Those solutions involved isolating or exterminating one particular community, saying that if we get rid of this community, all of our problems will be solved. I don't see a great deal of difference.
But this is why we need to, on this point...
Well, we need politicians. He hasn't yet invaded Poland.
He's not going to agree with you. He's not going to give you that answer. But I wanted to say, and the point I was going to make on that point, is that actually you need leaders to stand up and be internationalist right now. You need people to stand up and say, actually, yes, we do need to do more on foreign aid. Not cop this idea that somehow if you're funding foreign aid, you're not helping homeless people in Australia. Because this is a false dichotomy. It's not either or. We're all in this together. We're one world, and we actually need to work together to help each other out. Because we experience that fear if we don't.
Let me bring in our next questioner. Broden Kelly has a question, and then I'm going to bring Sean in because it actually relates to the United States. So, Broden.
Thank you. To Sean, as the American on the panel, is the choice between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump a choice between an endless global war on terror with Hillary and a less interventionist American empire under Trump?
Well, is this on?
Yeah.
I'll just say that I'm not done supporting Bernie yet. And I'm hoping that this convention turns out more interesting than the media would like you to think.
Are you saying that Bernie Sanders might make a late run? Not that I'm saying he's very old, it's a late run, but are you saying he might make a late run for power at the convention?
I'm saying that the Bernie camp has a few more things up their sleeve.
All right, okay. Well, give us your impression of Donald Trump then, as a Sanders supporter.
Well, I think just as you said, he's using demagoguery and fear peddling to bully his way into office, and I think that I think he needs to get shut down at all costs. I mean, we don't really want Hillary to get elected because there's a lot of corruption. There's a lot of this incident with the Benghazi was disgusting, but we need to inform the American public that there is also other options. There's Jill Stein and there's Gary Johnson. And I think what I've seen is a lot of the Republicans who aren't absolutely insane are moving over to the Gary Johnson camp. And that's, of course, good for us.
What do you think about what Trump actually said about Hillary Clinton in his nomination speech? He referred to her as a criminal. He's referring there, I suspect, to her emails and some of the Benghazi stuff. But he also said her legacy is death. I presume he means her legacy not as the former First Lady, but as the Foreign Secretary of the United States. Death, destruction, terrorism, and weakness.
Well, first off, I don't think he has much room to speak, considering that he's changing the norm of the dialogue in the U.S. towards a more, racially segregated, environment. So he's essentially making it okay for racial tensions to exist, and I think it's dangerous. And I don't think it's going to play out very well on the world stage either. But what he says is true. Then again, I think it's dangerous for a politician to start throwing out allegations like that. Because again, you're painting the establishment as it is as you know, all criminal, all corrupt, which, you know, there is a great deal of it. But, you know, there needs to be a more sophisticated approach to it than that.
Good luck with that. I saw his convention speech from that giant Trump sign with the 250 American flags behind him. Andrew, what did you think when you saw Trump's speech? And what do you think about the prospect of him becoming an American president? And is he one that Australia could deal with?
Well, there's two answers to it. I mean, I'm no great Trump fan, but I love what he's doing. I just love that he's shaking the place up. And if you want to just keep going with the major parties and just having cookie-cutter candidates, well, that's not Trump. You've had that in Australia for a very long time. If you're feeling disenfranchised, well, who's going to get off their ass and make a difference? I mean, which one of you guys are going to say, I'm ready to go, I'm ready to do it, I see your hand? So it's easy when things are tough to articulate the problem, right?
I think that's a hand looking to ask a question, so we'll get you...
No, he wants to run.
Oh, okay, you're putting up your... Okay, fair
enough.
I'll
vote for
the
guy too, mate. I'm ready to vote for you. It'd be un-Australian not to. but look, seriously, I'm just saying that we worry about all this stuff, but the big enemy here is complacency. The big enemy here is that 99% of people in this festival are not in this tent, all right? I mean, that's the reality. Thank you for being here. But if you just want things to keep going as they are, ministers having secret conversations, people donating money that you don't even know where the money's coming from, you know, all that sort of stuff, question time where half the time is your own government asking questions to your own ministers. I mean, that, it's all shit. I mean, you've got to seriously say that's got to change. So who's going to change it? All right, I mean, and you've got to get people in there. You've got to be able to know what's going on. And I'm not talking about the three major parties.
Keep that camera rolling.
Who love that stuff. But you've really got to you've got to be directly engaged. You'll be talking about online voting. You've got to be talking about taking away large union and corporation funding of elections. And you've probably got to bring it back to individual donations and a limit immediately declared the minute you give the dollar. And when a politician spends one of your dollars, they tell you in real time what they spent the dollar on. You don't have to go and FOI it 6 months later.
Yep. So, let me put it this. Keep that microphone just for a minute, because it's so exciting when you're holding it. You said Donald Trump is doing some good things. So let's just go through a couple of those promises. One, to build a wall across the Mexican border. Two, to ban all Muslim immigration. Do you include those in your assessment? Because they are top of mind.
Yeah, no, they're not in the good. What I love is that he's just shaking up the status quo, because I know what you'll get with Hillary is exactly the same stuff. So, look, in reality, back here in Australia, you know, you've got people saying inflammatory things that don't help. But in reality, our government spends around $500 million on appeasement measures to try and get, you know, better understanding in migrant communities of de-radicalisation. I mean, it's like asking a Catholic priest who's 80 years old to crack down on graffiti. I mean, we don't know how to control these errant minds who are honestly fearful of Western free democracy and are determined to kill to make a point. This is a massive challenge. And the fearful thing is here that I don't think any government knows what to do yet.
We'll come back to you. Sarah Hanson-Young, you might like to respond to some of what you just heard. And perhaps the endorsement of the endorsement of Donald Trump is one you might not share.
What I do agree with Andrew on is that Donald Trump is the non-establishment candidate. That's true. And that's why we can draw those parallels with what's going on here in terms of an increase in vote of micro-parties and independent candidates, whether or not they come from the left or the right, actually. And I think this issue of inequality and how it is being... how it is manifesting itself in elections, how it's manifesting itself in the kind of FU vote, if you like, the protest vote, is transcending that traditional left and right politic. And as politicians and as and our political parties, we actually do have to grapple with that, because the issue of inequality, the issue of people not being able to get jobs, not feeling secure, it's not that people feel afraid to walk down the street because they think they're going to be there's going to be a terrorist attack. People are afraid they're not going to be able to pay their rent at the end of next month, or that you know, if they have kids, what school they're going to go to. If these days you're told by the commentariat and by some politicians that unless you save up enough money and send your kid to a private school, then you're not being a good enough parent. And what happened to actually funding good public education where everybody could have access? And that is what we should be doing. The reaction to the Medi, it was, you know, as it was dubbed, the Medi-scare campaign during the election. The Liberal Party and Malcolm Turnbull have said, oh, it's unfair that people were frightened about Medicare. Well, rightly or wrongly, however the Labor Party played the politics on it, the message was that people are worried about changes to their access to health and education. Those inequality issues transcend politics.
So I'll just bring Andrew straight back in here, because I think you should respond to that as a doctor and a member of the Liberal Party.
So both parties are very good at scare campaigns because it often wins elections. If you're an incumbent government, it's usually most effectively run by the opposition. We did it on carbon tax, okay? A very potent scare campaign. Immigration.
I said and boats.
Same deal.
Remember those big We Stop the Boats mobile billboards that you
That's
had,
right.
guys?
Very effective.
Boats up and down them?
And
that was
Medicare.
Nice.
Well, I think we're fiercely agreeing. So,
No, I'm afraid.
So, and Medicare, the same deal. I mean, you have to have what we call in politics equities. If you don't have strength in an equity like health, a scare campaign can be run. So if you're going to try a co-payment, changes to pathology, changes to radiology, freezing the livelihoods of
2,000
GPs.
$2 billion in cuts to Medicare funding in the budget right now, for example.
Except that it keeps going up every year. Then you are free to run a scare campaign, and Australians are free to hear both sides of the story. There's one country where you won't have a scare campaign. It's North Korea.
Can I just borrow this for 1 minute, Sean? We're short one microphone, so if someone can bring one, if there's a spare one, that'd be great. So bring one up, because we're short one microphone. But actually, I just want to hear Andrew on this question of the freezing of doctors' rebates, which is obviously going to be a big issue going forward. If you acknowledge that there was some relevance to the scare campaign on Medicare, should your government change this obvious thing?
So we want to change the debate from quantity to quality. I want to know that I'm going to the best doctor in the world, getting the best care in the world. I want to know that if I'm diagnosed with cancer, that someone can keep me alive long enough so I can see my daughter get married 6 months from now. I want the best care the world has. That's fair enough. The answer to that is we need to debate quality of the healthcare system more than quantity. If we do that, the Liberals will survive and succeed. If it's a debate purely on quantity, we can never win the promise war.
Okay, so we managed to go from Donald Trump to healthcare in a single jump. If anyone's got a question, put your hand up. We'll get a microphone to you. We've got one over there. We'll get a microphone to you, sir. In the meantime, I want to bring Sean back in, because let's go back to the questions we were talking about. I know you wanted to jump in on that. So what were you going to say?
Well, I just wanted to pose a kind of a challenge to the panel, because based on my research, there is a great deal of automation happening now with the Internet of Things, with robotics, and industry, and also warfare. It's estimated that about 55% of the jobs, I believe, don't quote me on that, are going to be taken through automation in the future. Either way, whoever the candidate is, they're going to have to deal with this particular situation, as well as in Australia. I know that the Amazon warehouse, they're using robots in the warehouse instead of people now. I was just wondering what your thoughts were.
So really briefly, you're dead right. Half of the future jobs will all be in what we call science, technology, engineering, and math. It doesn't mean half the people become unemployed overnight. It means that we need to trend in that direction. More maths teachers coming out of education faculties. At the moment, Australians are free when they go to education faculty at university to decide if they want to be a health and PE teacher or not. I mean, we need to supply Australia with the teachers of the future, and we need to have more drive towards science and tech. If you're going to choose your profession, you have to just have your technology and quant in your toolbox. You've got to be able to read a spreadsheet if you're a nurse, because one day you'll be running your own show in the NDIS as a contractor. So keep your technology skills up, whatever you do, and arts and creativity and problem solving is actually part of that.
In the meantime, we've got a question from the floor. We'll go to you. And then we've got another question from the floor over in the middle here. We'll go to that woman after your question. Go ahead.
Is that working? My question is for Mr. Westmoreland. With the scare campaigns that's going on with the election over in the US, as a whistleblower in a very secretive environment that you came out of, do you think that what the parties are coming up with in their scare campaigns are going to make it even harder for whistleblowers to come out and tell the public what the real truth is and what's going on behind the scenes?
Good question, and we'll start by just getting Sean to clarify whether he considers himself a whistleblower.
Well, it's the technical definition of whistleblower would classify me as a whistleblower because of Edward Snowden and Chelsea Manning, and it's kind of come to encompass people who leak mass amounts of data. I saw what my program did. I saw what the effect of my my work did, and I had moral issues with that. I don't think that using drones is a very good strategy. It's a tactic, but it's being used as a strategy across the Middle East, and you're essentially only bombing people. There's no counterinsurgency going on there. There's no winning hearts and minds. You're just hovering over people, and if there is a threat, then bomb drops, and of course there is collateral damage. There are civilians that die. And
are the civilian deaths being covered up, literally covered up? Are they not being talked about, or are they being covered up?
Well, I can tell you there's several human rights organizations that have been logging people. They've been tracking the deaths of people on the ground. And there is photographic evidence of at least 200 people, a lot of them children. And that's only really in a number of strikes. I mean, for President Obama to come out and say that 64 to 116 civilians have died in this entire his entire presidency, essentially, it's brazen, and it's very obvious to anybody who's been working on the subject that that's disingenuous.
Can I ask you an obvious question? I know you found it very hard to live with the work that you found yourself doing. Did you witness the killing of civilians during the time that you were working with the drone program in Kandahar?
Well, here's the funny thing about the drone program. All right, you have a number of different positions. Everybody has individual responsibilities. Those responsibilities are kind of narrowly defined. So you have people who are imagery analysts. They're looking at the imagery and they're looking if there is actually suspicious behavior. And you have signals analysts that are analyzing the cell phone signals, the metadata, everything like that. You have the pilot, of course, and then you have the sensor operator who operates the camera. And then you have the number of technical jobs, which are really I think the only estimate I've seen is 187 positions.
Is it clear who presses the button to send the Hellfire missile onto a target?
Well, here's the thing. You have a pilot who presses the button, but there are people who make that button do something when you press it.
So they dilute the responsibility. Is that a deliberate thing to try and stop people feeling guilty about what they're doing?
I don't know if it's deliberate, as it's kind of it's efficient. It's a efficient way of distributing the responsibilities and making it so that things get done a lot faster.
So just the government line, Sean, and then I'd love your view on it, because obviously we're only showing what we're allowed to see. But you guys need to know that refuelers are 24/7 just flying up and down the Iraq border, okay, of Syria. About a dozen nations send fighter bombers up. They get refueled. They do their job. Quite often, they just come home having dropped nothing. you'll see little marks on these fighters. And I thought, what is this? Is this, you know, how many strikes you've had? They said, no, in the whole year we've been here, that's how many we've dropped. I mean, it's incredibly targeted. And the answer of who decides who presses the button, there's the general and then there's a lawyer. And it goes to legal review under the convention. And these guys will say, there's the target, that's the blast zone, there's the nearest civilian building, this is when people are moving, sorry, you can't drop the bomb. Now, if you could drop the bomb at any time you wanted, Raqqa would be flat by now, right? But it's not. There's almost no strikes in some of those IS cities because of the risk of civilian casualties.
So, Andrew, can I just to interrupt to clarify, yeah. Are you talking about the Australian rules of engagement
or the global rules of engagement?
Aren't they different? The American rules of engagement and the Australian rules of engagement are quite different, aren't they?
They're subtle, but they operate under the same command and control mechanism in the Middle East. But straight to the point, if they were just indiscriminate, there would be, I mean, the cities we think of in IS would be flat by now. They aren't, because lawyers decide if a bomb can be dropped.
Okay, so we are talking about slightly different things. I'm going to bring Sean back in because you're talking about the bombing campaign with fighter aircraft. He's talking about drones. I don't suppose they let you into the operation rooms of the drones. Okay, so Sean, is it different?
It is. It's a lot different, actually. The thing about
conventional aircraft. It
comes in, potentially drops a bomb, and then it leaves. The thing with the drones is it's loitering over there for days, weeks on end. And it's either under JSOC or it's under the CIA, so Joint Special Forces Operations Command, or the Central Intelligence Agency. The thing with the Central Intelligence Agency is they are not required to be transparent. The thing with JSOC is they're only answerable to the president. So they don't have to report through Congress in order for that to happen. So
is it, to your knowledge, to your sure knowledge, having worked there, were civilians killed and no one was told about it? The public, I mean.
As far as my working there, I've seen videos and I can say that I don't know how civilians were not killed. I mean, you're bombing houses, which they call compounds, and sometimes there's up to 30 people living in these places.
Yeah, Tony, can I?
It's multi-generational.
This cuts to the very core of the problem. With the discussion, particularly around drone strikes, a lot of the rhetoric talks about military targets as if you're dealing with a bunker, or even the term compound implies something that has military utility, that it's a walled enclosure. The fact is that that's the way a normal house is in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Syria. That's the way they're designed. And the idea of a military target is something that we all seem to conjure up an image of. The trouble is that it is almost invariably in a civilian infrastructure. The division between military and civilian in the Middle East, in Afghanistan, as I learned when I worked there over the years, is very, very indistinct. It's not, and that's not a deliberate kind of hiding the military amongst civilian populations. That's just the way it operates. It always has done. And so the idea that we are somehow prosecuting a war on terror by dropping bombs on military targets is a bit spurious, and inevitably you are going to cause civilian casualties.
And once you do, Peter, what's the implications? We know these group of whistleblowers, or whatever we'd like to call them, from within the drone program have come out and said that it is igniting the war on terrorism, not ending it.
Let me tell you about the conversations that I had in prison in Egypt with a lot of guys who would not consider themselves to be terrorists or extremists in the sense that we would. But these guys are saying to me, listen, you guys call us the terrorists. And yet we have Muslims who have the commitment to sacrifice themselves for a cause that they believe in. They say, you are firing Hellfire missiles from drones piloted by some guy sitting in a hut in Virginia. You fire these missiles on domestic compounds, you call them military targets, but invariably women, children, families, wedding parties are all hit by these things. Muslims suffer this every single day. And yet when one of our guys blows themselves up in the middle of a place in like Paris, you call us the terrorists. Now, I'm not saying that I agree with that argument, but when you're sitting in a place, in a prison in Egypt, it's actually a very, very difficult argument to have. And I have to agree with Sean that we are not winning the war on terror by hitting those targets, because every time, and I'm pretty sure you'd have seen this, every time we take out some IS leader, IS commander, there's at least a dozen more volunteers who fill in behind them, plus a whole bunch of individuals who, in the West, who are incredibly angry at what's being done. Unless we are prepared to engage in that argument, we are never going to win this conflict.
Sir Hanson-Young. And just while we're doing that, I know we've got a questioner in the middle there. We're going to come to you in a minute, but I actually have a specific question on this subject from Soulette. We'll go to Soulette first, and then we'll start taking hands up everywhere. We'll start with that lady in the middle after Soulette. So we'll get a microphone to Soulette, but please continue.
Hello? Yes. Peter, I couldn't agree with you more, actually. But I think it's not even just the issue of the perception and the lived experience of what's going on with these drone strikes at that point. One of the things that struck me most, Andrew and I actually were, the last time we saw each other, we were in the Middle East, embedded with the Australian Defence Force for 2 weeks, looking at these programs. And the thing that struck me was that there is no plan for the humanitarian rebuild in these areas at all. So not only is there a build-up of resentment for what's going on in terms of the attack on civilians day to day, but then there is absolutely no parallel plan that's going alongside the military operation that says, well, once we've cleaned out these IS bastards, this is who's going to come in and rebuild the town and support you and rebuild the hospitals and make the community safe again. And when you look at what happened in what's going on in Afghanistan now, going backwards, and it was only yesterday, there was 85 people killed, hundreds other injured. Things in Kabul, in Afghanistan, are no safer than they were 10 years ago. So without that kind of parallel process of humanitarian rebuild, and who's going to pay for that, the international community has to pay for that, then we're setting ourselves up for failure.
Can I just put this to you as the obvious follow-up question, which is, do you think the war on terrorism prosecuted in the Middle East against ISIS and in Afghanistan against the Taliban, who, let's not forget, did in fact run a whole country and make it a haven for terrorism from which the September 11 attacks were planned. Do you think that war by the countries that are hit by those terrorists should stop? Is that what you're saying?
I can't see that at the moment where the end game is. And without some more clarity about how the operation continues, where the humanitarian rebuild is, where the diplomatic emphasis is, it seems to be a recipe for disaster.
Okay, I'm just going to quickly bring Andrew back in, then we'll go to Soulette, then the other questions from the middle. Go ahead.
Look, you always tempt fate when you say it, but while we were there, there'd been 4 attacks by the Taliban in 5 months. There was another one after we left. But look, this will be controversial, but for 98% of Afghanistan, life just goes on, and it is a relatively peaceful country. 15% of Afghanistan has Taliban activity, and the popularity of Taliban sits on under 20%. In most places, well under 5. So the goal here, in the absence of a counterfactual, I don't know what would have happened if Saddam was still there. But I do know that if I take away any states where terrorism can have a comfortable home, then I have the problem I want to have, which is wiping out what remains, because I am determined so that you guys never have to put your seatbelts on and have what's happening in Europe happen in Australia. In 2000, when we saw 9/11, if I had said to you that let's fast forward to 2016 and there'll have been 2, maybe 3 incidents of terrorism on our shores 12 years later, you would have never believed me. So we are doing very well to contain it. Our intelligence services really are down to the hundreds that have tried to go to Iraq and Syria, and the few hundred here. We are doing the best possible job I think any government on both sides can, to have only had that record so far. Afghanistan is not the disaster it's painted in the media, and plenty of my friends live happily there, peacefully, and if we can do the same thing in Iraq and Syria, then we're way better than having done nothing at all.
Okay, I'm going to quickly bring Sean in to respond to that, because I spoke to you out the back, and your view was it was a mistake for the United States to leave in such large numbers Afghanistan, having gone in there in the first place. They went off to invade Iraq instead of actually fixing the problem they started in Afghanistan. Is that the problem as you see it?
Right. Well, I do think that the way we've been conducting ourselves in Afghanistan has been flawed from the beginning. I mean, Donald Rumsfeld telling us, or like basically sending us into Iraq shortly after we went into Afghanistan and basically bombed the hell out of the place. Of my opinion, I think that if you bomb a country, you have a responsibility to help rebuild it. And I don't think we've really, as an international community, really taken that responsibility on and put forth an honest effort in that. I mean, you have a police force, which is, I mean, you can go look at, watch documentaries about it. I mean, there are, you know, child rapists in the police force, and there are Northerners who are being sent to the South. And I mean, they're as different as, you know, we are to the Pashtuns. They're totally different cultures. They hate each other. And, you know, they have incentives to, like, dominate. So I think there's a lot of problems with the way we've managed it, and sending in troop surges and pulling them out, sending them in, pulling them out. People, it doesn't build up trust, and people need to feel safe to rebuild, and the situation needs to stabilize.
Okay, I'm going to quickly go to Sulet. We'll have one more question on these general subjects. Where is Sulet?
Yep, just here.
Go on.
The question is, first of all, is drone warfare incredibly expensive? I think Australia's got a future budget of something like $2 billion it's planning to spend in the future on drones. And maybe, Sean, you can tell us, how much does a Hellfire missile cost in terms that an average person might understand? And my second question is around the idea that metadata, so phone signals or your locational data from Twitter, whatever, is used to track, you know, where people move for drone strikes or otherwise, that information is gathered. Given that overnight a Washington newspaper reported that the very popular Twitter hashtag of the DNC leaks, the Democratic National Convention's leaks, leaked emails, had mysteriously disappeared from the trending list on Twitter, even as WikiLeaks released a new trove of these leaked emails, is Twitter censoring leaks? Do we need to be worried about our metadata from Facebook, Twitter, or Google, and the privacy around that for all of us, not just people who might be droned halfway around the world?
Okay, we'll go through this one quickly so we can go to other subjects, but what do you think about this? You've obviously worked at the interface. I said earlier the Google office was sitting right next to the drone warfare office. Is there a sort of generic connection between these social media collection sites, the way that technology for doing it, and the technology that's used in the war on terrorism?
Yeah, I can touch on that. The thing is Twitter, Facebook, whatever, it's all used to build up metadata along with cell phone signals to, they compile a profile on the individual, and they determine whether or not they're guilty or innocent based off of this data that they've obtained. Oftentimes there are not there's no human on the ground to really confirm anything. So it's really, it's like, I don't know how many of you have taken statistics, but you know, if you have taken statistics, you know that just one variable that's off can just throw off the entire thing. So we're really basing our decision to kill somebody off of purely quantitative research as opposed to qualitative. And I think there's a problem with that. In terms of the price of this program, you'll see that there's more and more contractors that are taking up positions and parts of the mission. And
well, I mean, they're advertising now for 3,500 new drone pilots in the United States, for example. So I guess this is an expanding area.
It is expanding, and it's not going to end with the Middle East. You're going to see police forces who have adopted this. I know just recently there was the shooter in Dallas that was taken out by a bomb-like robot. And, you know, it's just going to keep happening more and more, especially as this type of technology becomes more and more autonomous.
Just one more quick question for you, and then I'll just quickly hear from some of the other panelists on this subject. But this idea that Google does the same sort of things that intelligence agencies do, they're collecting your commercial data. Is there any link that you know of between these kind of corporations and the military and the security services?
None that I can talk about, but I can nod my head. And it's...
all I those mean, people it, playing Pokemon Go right now.
Yeah, okay. You know what's interesting is every tool that you can find in the CIA, you can find open source somewhere on the internet as far as investigating somebody. It's all put in different places. But, I mean... There's of course technicians. There's coders that are working on both sides of the fence, you know. And I know that the NSA, according to the Washington Post, when they did a study of it, there is about 2,000 companies that basically compose the infrastructure of the NSA.
Andrew, does that worry you? And then I'll come to Sarah.
No, it doesn't at all. So, you know, if you want to throw away your flyby card and your everyday rewards, go ahead. But the benefits of sending your data out into the atmosphere like that far outweighs the risks. And if it doesn't, just get rid of the stuff and don't use it. But we use it because it gives us so much utility. Also, I hate to say it, but you're all pretty irrelevant. No one really cares very much about your data unless they're trying to get some money out of your pocket. So just beware when you go shopping.
Can I just give you a simple example for why that might not be, that might be a bit simplistic.
It's a huge waste of money.
I work on the Q&A program, as you know, and every now and then we get a questioner ask a controversial question. And before you know it, all of their data is on the front page of the News Limited newspapers, and people have trawled through their life and tried to find out what they think about X, Y, and Z. And if 3 or 4 years ago they said something offensive, look out. Your freedom of speech is at risk.
Tony, what I find fascinating about this debate right now, and I know you want to move on to other questions, but that as members of Parliament, we've been able to sit here and talk about this, yet our Parliament as a institution does not debate when we go into war. And I just find that extraordinary. So we can come here on a panel with you, facilitated by you, to talk about it. But really, our Parliament should be deciding whether we go to war or not, whether we're dropping bombs or not, and it's time we actually fix that.
Okay, time to move on to other subjects. We had a questioner down the middle there. We'll quickly race a microphone over to you. Stand up and we'll be able to spot you more quickly. There we go. Go ahead.
Sorry to keep you on the topic of the Middle East, but as a student of the region, I would like to know if Peter Greste thinks there is hope for future Middle Eastern revolutionary movements, or whether the region is set for increased authoritarianism as a means of achieving some kind of stability, particularly with regards to Turkey after the recently failed coup.
Okay, good question. We'll let Peter answer that alone. We've got a few hands up around the audience, so we'll try and get microphones to you. Over in the middle there, we've got one, and we'll let Peter answer that.
Okay, it's a really interesting question. I was in prison alongside people like Alaa Abdel Fattah, Ahmed Meher, Ahmed Domad. These are guys who were leaders of the secular revolution of January 25th in 2011. As I said, they were in prison along with me. And it's quite sobering to see just how many of those optimistic revolutionaries, the guys that were seculars, that were committed to democracy, freedom of speech, that were committed to political, genuine political reform and revolution in the Middle East, and those are the guys that really got the ball rolling. To see them in prison really gives me no hope at all, and I think this is one of the failures of Western policy, the fact that we encouraged those movements to start but never actually supported them once they started to falter. I don't have a great deal of optimism at the moment. I think that Recep Tayyip Erdogan, the Turkish president, is conducting a purge, is taking advantage not just of the political instability that's followed the attempted coup, but also taking advantage of his government's own strategic position, because the West isn't going to let him fall and risk yet more chaos. It will support him as undemocratic as he is. So I'm afraid I'm not optimistic at all. I'm really not.
Okay, we've got a band going past it. That's not going to stop us. Let's go to the question down the back there. Just imagine you're doing this in the Caribbean during a funeral.
Thanks so much for coming, and big shout out to Festival Tony. We all love you.
Thank you. We will take that as a comment. Yeah.
Yes, thank you. The rise of Hansenism Mark II appears to me to have drawn two distinct responses from the political establishment, and I guess particularly those on the left side of politics. So on the one hand, the more like centre-left, or perhaps, so in our case, Labour, and certainly I would include the Liberals in this, appear to want to speak to the fears of Hanson voters with regards to the perceived link between Islam and terrorism. And on the other hand, you have the, like, what you would call maybe the harder left, and in our case, maybe the Greens, that wish to call out racism as they see it and emphasise that Islam is not inherently violent. My question to the panel is, given that most people read headlines about terrorist attacks and immediately think to themselves, is this ISIS related? Was it somebody who, you know, calls themselves a Muslim? And like, that there is a clear link in the public perception's mind between these two things. Which response do you think is most appropriate or constructive?
Okay, we'll get a quick answers on this. Start with Andrew.
Yeah, so definitely responding to extreme thoughts with extreme language and having protesters from X turning up and fighting Y is not the answer. The anecdote and the inoculation from extremism is just a civil, open, constructive democracy. Because can I tell you, I've got a friend who teaches at the Muslim school in Brisbane. I said to her, is there a little bit of extremism creeps in there? Are they the few? She said, you know what? All they want to do is party. They are just like all the other young girls, okay? But they're wearing a scarf, right? They are just the same. And if you have a civil, thriving, capitalism-driven democracy, they're all going to want it in the end.
Have you thought about leaving the Liberal Party and joining the Party Party? Now, I'll get you to answer that question, Paul. But in the meantime, let's get Alex, 23, university student from Victoria, to stand up. Where's Alex? Alex is around there. Okay, we'll get a question. We'll get a microphone to you. We're going to come to your question in a moment. Go ahead, Sarah.
Look, I think racism needs to be called out, of course. The idea of people jumping to conclusions like that idiot George Christensen a day ago. I mean, this is a guy who he wants to make his political career out of demonising others. He's probably a little bit put out that Pauline Hanson is getting more votes and more attention. So what does he do? He goes out and says that a guy who's distressed with a family dispute sets himself on fire in outside a mainland's police station. Oh, it must have been terrorism. And then he goes off half-cocked around the issues in Munich only 24 hours later. And I don't think extremism from any side is particularly helpful at all in this debate. And if you wanted to drive isolation internally in Australia, demonising people is the best way to do it. And those people are only feeding the fear and the isolation.
Okay, we've covered this question quite a lot. I'm going to go to something different. We've got a question from Alex from Victoria.
Cool, thank you. My question's to Andrew. It's the Liberal Party's policy to have a plebiscite on marriage equality rather than a free vote. I'm wondering what you think the value of a national plebiscite is, given it's not going to be legally binding and it might have a pretty negative psychological impact on LGBTI people and their families.
Okay, can I go to Andrew? Hold your horse. I'll go to Teri first. Haven't heard from you for a while. Go ahead, Teri.
Well, actually, I'm Tony mentioned at the beginning, I'm pretty proud to be, for the first time in the alternative government of this nation, we've got an LGBTI-specific person in the front bench, and that's me. So I now have responsibility to seek out disadvantage and to seek out discrimination and seek to change the nation's policies on that. It would be good if the government could also have a portfolio of that nature sometime soon. If you could take that to the party room along with the reforms to question time that you mentioned before, that'd be great.
Are you trying to get ministers to come out of the closet?
I'm trying to get them to come out as allies, at least, of the LGBTI community. So for me, look, I think the money is a really important question, right? Like, it's an expensive plebiscite, but that is not the main issue with the plebiscite. The main issue with the plebiscite is it is really, really going to divide our community, and it's just a stupid idea. Like, it is just idiotic to say that a majority of people need to vote to determine that a minority can have the same rights as them is, when you articulate it, it just, it's self-evident how stupid it is. So from my perspective, I would like it not to go ahead, because I think we should just do our job and pass marriage equality when we go back on the 30th of August.
So...
Let me just ask a quick question, though.
So should Labor vote against it?
Well, we haven't seen the legislation. It doesn't exist. It's hypothetical. Like, the
government keeps saying... But you can imagine what it's like.
I can't imagine what it's like, because we haven't seen it yet. Now, look, we're resuming on the 30th of August. We've got 7 sitting weeks this year. At what point is the government actually going to produce the draft legislation for the plebiscite that it took to the federal election? At what point are we going to see the terms on which the majority of Australians are being asked to vote on the rights of a minority? When we've seen the legislation, then I think it's appropriate to start asking us how we're going to vote on it. But sight unseen, I think that that's actually pretty unrealistic for a government to be saying, oh, what's Labor going to do? What are you guys going to do? Well, when are you going to do something? When are you going to get off your backsides and actually produce something that's going to advance marriage equality? That's the real question.
Can I will stick with you for a moment, even though you say it's the wrong thing to do. So if it's a matter of principle that a plebiscite vote should not go ahead, if it's a matter of principle, as you just stated at the beginning, why would you vote for one?
Well, Tony,
no matter what the legislation says.
As I said to you, I want to see the legislation. As I also said to you,
so the principle is
I
flexible.
Think that the government is the principle should have flexible. A free vote in their party room and on the floor of the parliament to support marriage equality by passing a law to amend the Marriage Act. We didn't need a plebiscite when John Howard changed the Marriage Act. We didn't need a plebiscite then. We don't need a plebiscite for all of the ridiculous things that they want to do, like the $100,000 degrees. We don't need a plebiscite when Malcolm Turnbull wants to float an increase to the GST or the idea that we won't fund public schools anymore. Why should we have a plebiscite to vote on people's rights? Look, if the only way to advance marriage equality, as they say it is, as George Brander said it is on television today, is to have a plebiscite, well, then the fact that they haven't produced the legislation yet suggests that they're not very committed to it, in my view.
Okay, let's go to Andrew.
Sure. So... I didn't hear anyone talking like that when Ireland had their plebiscite, right? And Ireland rejoiced in having...
Ireland had a referendum.
Well, let's have a referendum. I'm easy. I want a public say in this area. That's what I mean.
No, no, but are you going to
don't
go...
Don't skate
no,
around no, the reality.
The High Court says we don't
the Irish had their say in a public vote. I'm happy to debate the nuance, but
no,
secondly...
No, it's not a debate. Hang on, just wait. Secondly. Just pause there for a second. Just hear me out. Yep. Ireland had a binding referendum. Yes. Are you now saying that's what Australia should have?
No, because we don't need that. Okay. And in answer to your question, about a third of our party room supports gay marriage, and that still doesn't mean the people should not have their say.
Hold on, let him
say. I'm an old-fashioned guy, right? I'm an old-fashioned guy, and I would just love everyone to have their vote on issues that are not in major party platforms, and that's there's many issues like that. And
hey,
you know
guys,
what, from my electorate...
I understand the passions are high in the room,
sure.
That's fine, but you won't be able to hear it.
I don't come from an inner city electorate, right? In my electorate, my people want to have a say, and they made that very, very clear, and I'm the only politician in the entire country, the only one, right, that has said, whatever the result is in my electorate, I will vote yes or no according to the result of my plebiscite, and I think we're a mature democracy that can do it. Whatever you say about the way the Irish did it, I celebrated their result, and I think Australia is big enough to do
exactly the same. Can I just pause? So, now just hold on for that 1 second, then I'll pass it over to Sarah. But are you saying this is not, in fact, a national vote? It's a vote electorate by electorate, as far as you see it. Because if some electorates decide no, are you saying there, even though you might support
the plebiscite. Even though you might support same-sex marriage, you'll listen only to what your electorate says, not to what the nation says. Is that what you're saying?
With the greatest respect to people who have very formed views in this area, 149 members of the reps are going to vote the way they want to. I will vote the way my electorate tells me in a plebiscite. And in the absence of a plebiscite, if we suddenly the government fell, I would poll my entire electorate with a household survey, reply paid, and I would say to them, if you care enough to put a one in a box, lick it and put it in a post box, I want to know what you think about gay marriage, and I will vote on that result.
Sarah Hanson-Young.
I think one of the reasons why the whole plebiscite issue is still kicking around is A, because the right-wingers inside the coalition wanted to find a way of stalling the reform from happening. And let's be honest about that. They played their last card. It was the issue that was the final nail in the coffin for Tony Abbott as Prime Minister, and now we've got grumps on the backbench in the Liberal Party still trying their hardest to stop this from happening. The fact is, I think the public are sick and tired of the politics being played, even in the Parliament, over this issue. The first time I ever voted on a marriage equality bill was in 2009. It was my first private member's bill ever. Five people voted for it. Now, we would probably see, if there was a free vote in the Parliament, it would pass. Things have come so far, and I think that's extremely important to acknowledge, but still we have people playing games with the parliamentary trickery to stop it from happening. So I totally understand why some people say, well, why shouldn't the public make up its mind? Because the public have come so far and they want to see it happen. I think politicians, we should just have the bill, put it to a free vote, and it would get passed and we'd move on. But I don't... having said that, Tony, I don't want to see marriage equality held hostage for years and years to come because politicians want to play politics with it. And if it is going to be left to the only way through is to be have it left to the public, then it's got to be a fair process, a fair question, and ultimately what the public vote for, which I believe overwhelmingly will be for marriage equality, then it should happen, no questions asked.
Okay, just pause. We've got a few people with their hands up. I can't see the people with the microphones, but let's go to this side first. Thank you very much. There's a young lady with a hat on just there. She's had a hand up for a long time. Then we'll come back down to this side of the room, which hasn't had a question. But I'd like to hear some more from the audience now. Go ahead.
Thanks, Tony.
Shut up, Tony!
Okay.
Hi, everyone. Shout out to Barnaby, wherever he is.
Yeah, sorry, I forgot to deliver my apologies for Barnaby Joyce, who, for some unknown reason, couldn't make it here. 24 hours ago, I think they discovered this fact. Thank you very much. Go ahead.
I'm a medical student at Deakin University. My question is to Mr. Lemming. I have heard that the coalition is planning to allow universities to deregulate course fees. I'm wondering how much you paid for your university education and whether you think it's fair for my generation to pay even more for theirs.
Thank you. I just wanted to finish with Sarah's question and just in one sentence say, please don't let apathy be the enemy of this plebiscite. Don't think it's an easy win. I know most of you have a view that it will be an easy win. With apathy and not holding it with a general election, you're at a high risk of a low voter turnout and a result you don't expect. On to your question, ma'am. I didn't catch your first name. There's no plan to deregulate fees. That policy is no longer our party's policy. But of the two parties that, of the two universities that deregulated fees thinking the policy would be passed, none of them increased their fees. I paid in my last year of my medical degree HEX. So I came in and I graduated in 1990 when Paul Keating brought it in.
Okay, I'm going to bring Teri in because I think your shadow... Oh, sorry.
Well, the HEX fees in those days was probably a few hundred dollars a semester. Yeah. Well, is that too? Because I was in my last year of university. That's what HEX was, wasn't it?
I paid nothing.
Yes, so you're a year older than me.
I paid nothing. In actual fact, the New South Wales government paid me to go to university to become a teacher. I'm just saying things have changed a lot.
I paid all my degrees since, I'll have you know. So I've done plenty since that I have paid X for.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, when you're on a bit of a higher wage, though. I mean, let's be honest.
Well, there's no need to have any
There's
no envy around this. It's just reality.
Well, it's not about envy. I mean, whenever people say the word envy in politics, that's code for saying don't complain about the fact that inequality is rising, and it is rubbish. It is rubbish to just say that's envy. Now, I paid Keating era hex as well, so I paid, frankly, the answer is bugger all. Bugger all in terms of
hex. You can boo now as well, like you did me.
And like Andrew, I've paid a lot for some university I've studied since. But I think the question is actually really one about fairness. I mean, Tony paid nothing. It's hard to believe that he's older than Andrew or I, but he is. But when I was in practice, I hired some lawyers who were maybe 5-10 years younger than me, and they were paying the Howard era hex, which meant that they were going to have debts well into their 30s, 40s, and possibly 50s, some of them. But imagine the Turnbull era hex. Imagine if this government gets its wish. Like, I heard what Andrew just said about it not being policy. We'll see what they do. I don't trust the Liberals on higher education fees because their natural inclination as well as their historical record has always been to increase higher education costs in this country. But look, imagine paying Turnbull era hex. You know, in the US, there are some people who are still paying off the university degrees when they're on Social Security. When they're in retirement on Social Security, I don't want to have a system in this country that means that people are paying off university fees for their entire life. And I really don't want a system in this country that means that people do not go to university to start with because they do not want burdens of debt that are going to drag them down their whole life. And that is the natural consequence of continuing to increase debts for university in this country. And it's a problem for the individual, yes, but it is a problem for our whole nation when people from working class backgrounds have debt that they weren't able to pay off as quickly. It's a problem for our whole nation when people won't go into lower paying jobs, community sector jobs, not-for-profit organisation jobs, because as well as having to take lower pay, it takes them longer to pay off a crushing debt that gets indexed with inflation. It is not appropriate for this country. If we want to do something about the rising tide of inequality, we have to make sure that people have access to higher education. We have to reform negative gearing. We have to make sure schools are funded properly. We have to deal with the fact that quantity does matter in health because it actually does matter if 23 or 24 million people can get healthcare or whether it's only 12 million people who can get the healthcare they need. All of these things actually matter and they have to be dealt with by your government now.
I'm going to take Peter out of his global focus and bring him in on education.
I've got to hold up my hand as well. I think I squeaked in just under the wire before hex was introduced, so I'm with Tony's generation on this. Look, one of the things I've seen around the world is, and I've spent the last 25 years living in the developing world, in Africa and in Latin America and the Middle East and so on, and I know it's stating the bleeding obvious that education is what really lifts these places out of poverty. To me, it seems like a bit of a contradiction, Andrew, to hear you say earlier that we need to have an investment in technology and that's where the future jobs are going to be if we're not going to invest in the people who are supposed to take on those jobs.
Now, I said I'd go to a question over on this side. We've got our microphones. There's a young lady with a hand up right here. Go ahead.
Hi, so I'm stepping back a question or five to discussion over general Medicare, Medicare health campaigns. So speaking from a purely economic perspective, what is the economic benefit of the government funding my female sexual health check versus me just using a yeast infection to open a bakery and sell some ciabatta instead?
Sarah.
I reckon you could write some great questions for question time. Can you imagine the blushing of some of those old blokes on the front bench having to answer some of those? I've got a staffer here, we might come and find you. Great question. It does come down to this issue of prioritisation and what we value. And when it comes to investment in access to the doctor, access to hospitals, when it comes to the issue of education, why is it that it's the only economic driver we've seen put forward by the Turnbull government at this election was a $50 billion tax cut to businesses with this view that please keep dreaming because the trickle-down effect will somehow give everybody a pay rise or a job. it was well and truly rejected by the community. People are sick and tired of being told that trickle-down economics works, and they're over it, and they want to see some honesty. And why aren't, if we can direct fund tax cuts, then why can't we be putting that money instead into public services? Because, you know, when you pay a teacher a bit more, or you pay somebody to study, or you increase the level, the pitiful amount of youth allowance, and you increase it, that money gets spent almost instantly. It goes into the economy, people have to eat, people have bills to pay. It's a much better way of circulating and dealing with the issue of inequality in the long run.
Now, Sean has been patiently listening to this discussion. I'd quite like to get an American perspective on this. Go ahead.
Well, in the US, you have about three different ways to fund your education. You have competitive scholarships. You have the military.
Is that how you did it, by the way?
I went through the military. And I'll just, I guess now that I'm on it, I'll focus on that. So that's actually one of the ways that they recruit people in the U.S. is they promise them a paid for education. And particularly in Black and Hispanic communities, that's quite attractive because they're not really educated about the breadth of all the other options there are. I know for me, I had the Pell Grants, and I also had a lot of calamity happening in my family at the time. So I mean, my grades weren't the best, and I decided that I would just follow in my family's footsteps and I would join the military. And, I would serve my time and I would get out and I would, get the Montgomery GI Bill, which is now the post 9/11, and go to college. I know a lot of people, especially in veterans organizations, who went in with the same idea of changing their social status from somebody who's poor, who has to work at Walmart, or to somebody who can do something that is respectable or considered respectable by society. I know a lot of those guys and women as well who now have mental issues because they had to go kill people or they watched their buddy die. And I think it's, personally, I think education should be universal. I think everybody should have that option. That shouldn't be used as a leverage against people to get them to join the military. I'm sure Andrew disagrees.
Let's see if he does.
Okay, you get out of college after the military, and you're pretty much useless. Like, I mean, I had a lot of issues when I got out. I had adjustment disorder, which is, I think everybody has that, for a period of a few years, and then I had a bomb explode next to me. So within the same amount of time that I realized that I was responsible for over 200 people dying. I went and studied international relations, and here I am listening to talking heads and people who, think they know how it is. They think they know, what the military's like, and they're teaching me about it. And I mean, I'm looking at all these other kids who never had to go through that, and they're just passing through with no problem. I just wish that wasn't, like that they call it the poverty draft, I wish the people in the US didn't have to go through that. And I mean, I don't know what it's like in Australia, but, it's, to kind of get back to what Andrew was saying, with the growing automation of jobs and everything, how you do need more funding into the education as far as science and technology. I mean, that can only really go so far. I mean, as far as logical, thinking and logical patterns, I mean, computers are a lot better than humans. And in science, that's more or less what you're dealing with. I would say we actually need more funding into the arts. We need to, we need more creative thinking, because that's something the computers aren't very good at.
Let me bring Andrew in, because you wanted him to respond to that. There's a young lady with a hand up right in the middle there. We'll get a microphone to you. We're going to try and get to as many questions as we can in the next few minutes. Go ahead.
Yeah, Sean, I mean, Australia, if you go around country towns, you'll see all our memorials to the young guys who were our armies and gave their lives, and that's the horrible reality, that we were sending our brightest and smartest door-to-door in Afghanistan, kicking doors in, trying to find rebels and Mujahideen, and then more recently terrorists. We're not going to do that anymore, and that's part of the drone program, is that we don't want to put our young people at that risk. No matter how well trained they are, it's a 50-50 proposition that someone behind there has a grenade. So in getting the military back into civvy street again, as they call it, when you go to America and they have worn 90% of this pain for us, right? The size of their military and how much they've done to protect the interests of the rest of us, you don't realise. But when you walk around and you're wearing cam, as we do as politicians in America, if we're on a military deployment, having people in the little shops and the servos say, thank you, sir, for your service. You know, we never do that here in Australia. And that is probably the first step to getting our young blokes back and feeling like they're part of Australia again.
Okay, I'm going to go to that question in the middle. Go ahead.
Hi, I'm a university student from Brisbane. We speak about being a mature democracy. Does the panel think that this booing and jeering in this session is conducive to a mature conversation?
Okay, Teri, I'll bring you in on that. Do you want to diss the audience? You might get booed and jeered for it.
I don't mind. Actually, I think it's great that people are passionate.
Yeah. I think that's... Sarah, you want to actually make a point there?
Look, I think we have to find all different ways to engage with the electorate and with the public. And, whether that's... A lot of people think that now, if you've got to be a politician, you've got to have a Facebook, you've got to have it. Well, you now need to be on Snapchat. That's how you engage with people. That's one way of engaging with people. But with that, of course, comes a lot of the negativity. And all you need to do is look up my Twitter feed and you can see what people say. In fact, just before we started, some guy, I said, looking forward to Q&A with Tony Jones at Splendour in the Grass. And he said, I hope someone bombs it. This is his right. I don't know if that was to you or to me, Tony, but...
Let's just say we both embrace that.
We both embrace it. And so, there is a level of ridiculousness that comes with that kind of broadening of public debate. I wish that those keyboard warriors or keyboard cowards were a bit more mature in their way that they want to engage. But, from a politician's perspective, I have to hear what you guys want to say, what you feel, what you think. It's part of the conversation. Yes, let's try and be respectful, but don't feel like you have to gag yourself because you're worried that you might upset somebody. Just do it in... You don't have to offend people to have an opinion. And I think some of my colleagues back in Parliament House could take that on board as well. It's not just something for the public.
Anyway, people got excited for a moment. We said calm down. You did. Terrific. So we've got another question over on this side. There we go. Excellent sprinting. Yes, correct.
Hi, Andrew. I actually live in Thornlands in your seat.
Hi, my suburb.
And just backtracking to what you said before, don't send me a letter. Don't waste taxpayer money on the plebiscite. Yep. And just, sorry to comment. And
thank you.
Can you just make it happen?
All right, thank you. Message on
okay.
board.
Okay, question right down the front here.
Hi.
Can you stand up? Sorry.
Oh, I can stand up.
Thank you.
We seem to be seeing in some areas, and especially in mainstream media, a lot of populist denigration of any group or cause that's seen by some parts as being other, whether that be refugees or marriage equality or even safe schools. How do you think as a community and those of you who are in the position to frame the debate, we can change the perception that treating others with respect and dignity is somehow a far left principle and not just simply the right thing to do?
Okay, now unless I get thumbs up from the organisers to keep going, that probably will be our last question. Someone can give me the thumbs up, we can keep going. But Teri, I'll bring you in straight away on that.
Thank you. Look, we just had an election.
Not the audience. There may be an act waiting to come on, I don't know.
You don't want to hear us sing, seriously. Look, during the election, somebody leafleted my electorate with an unauthorised, anonymous flyer about how I was really like a massive barracker for late-term abortion and how I really wanted everyone to have one. And there was diagrams, and that was anonymous. And the anonymous nature of those sorts of pieces of paper has been around for years. It's always happened in elections, unfortunately. But what I think, you know, when Sarah was talking before about what happens online, the anonymity really does disinhibit people. I mean, it's the principle that was in The Invisible Man, right? The famous novel. The idea that you somehow, because people don't know what you're doing, you start to lose your moral compass and you start to do things that you wouldn't do if everyone else could see you, I think is really playing out, particularly online at the moment. And then those people feel emboldened, I think, and that's also catching hold in the sense of it's becoming normalised and okay to say really things that never would have been said 10 years ago or 20 years ago. In such an open and mainstream way. You've always had people on the fringes and extremes saying things, but I think narratives are taking hold. I think it's something probably more, and I'm not one of these, oh, the media's all terrible, blame Peter like people like Peter types.
I'm going to blame us.
Well, two thumbs up to that. But I do think it is important that we all in our own daily lives show leadership. And the calling out point that Sarah made before, look, you actually do need to stop and say, what you just said is not okay. Even when it's someone with whom you vehemently disagree, I've got to say, I hated the slut-shaming of Pauline Hanson that went on last week. You know, if you had said to me, News Limited's going to find a way to make you feel sorry for Pauline Hanson, I would have said, that's pretty unlikely. And yet that's what happened. So I think we've all got to speak out about it. We've all got to practice what we preach on that in that regard ourselves. We've all got to catch ourselves when we do it. We all, I think, say things that we regret. It's actually about shining that light on, that public light on people's conduct and actually saying, well, this is what is not and is acceptable in an open democracy, and not getting pushed back by the people who say, you're just trying to stop my free speech, you know, those people, because actually everyone's entitled to speak freely, but that implies an entitlement to freely respond with disagreement and disapproval.
Okay, I've been told by the organisers we can't take any more questions because there is something happening after us. So I'll quickly get everyone on the panel to respond briefly to the point about respect and how you deal with the lack of respect to people designated as the other.
Yeah, I have a problem. I'm a journalist, an Australian journalist, but I've also been out of the country for 25 years, as I said earlier, and I think I've been absolutely appalled at the level of public debate in the media in Australia. I think it's been a colossal failure.
Hang on, stay put, because we can keep going. We've got a reversal of that opinion. Okay, all right.
I think there's been a colossal failure of Australian media to its civic responsibility to encourage and support rational, civilised public debate. And I think that we need to see, and there are all sorts of reasons why that's happened, technological reasons and so on. We won't go into that right now, but I do think that we have that the Australian media, the press in particular, needs to step up and accept that it's partly responsible for what's been taking place in public debate.
I'll quickly say to those people who are leaving, that's absolutely fine. We know you've got other appointments. Thank you for being here. Those who want to stay, that's fine too. We'll try and get to a couple more people with their hands up. We've got a microphone. We'll go to... Well, we didn't go to anyone right up the back there, so let's go up to the middle. We've got two people there sitting next to each other with their hands up. We'll give them the microphone. There we go. That's okay, guys.
Hi, I just have a question for Andrew. My father is now a veteran. He was working with the Special Forces, and unfortunately, he now suffers from depression, stress, like really bad health issues. How is it that sending drones, he wasn't
like involved at the front. He was logistics, so he was like this guy here. He was third party. He was helping to implement this. How is not sending people on the front line and just drones still not crapping them up? Like, how is that protecting them? It's still affecting them.
Yeah, we'll go to Andrew and Sean on that subject. So go ahead.
Well, respectfully, I don't know your full situation or your father's, but this idea that because they're not on the front line, they're not going to be affected is false, and we're now realising there are massive mental health issues coming back out of the Middle East. You're quite right.
Yeah, Sean.
I kind of want to get back to this whole idea that drones save lives, because I don't agree with it. I think it prolongs the situation. It delays the negative effect on our society. I mean, when you're just bombing people, you're creating enemies. When you're doing it with an autonomous, unmanned aircraft, I mean, it's perceived on the ground as cowardly. So I think it's that whole argument, and kind of getting back to what you were saying as far as it's saving lives even on our side, there's I know of at least two suicides that were related to, well, people I know knew these people. And I know that I have suffered from a lot of depression as well. Basically, I don't know how you cannot suffer from depression knowing that you're killing people. And with the knowledge that, you know, not all of those people were bad.
Did you get the help you needed, by the way?
No. I mean, basically they gave me a bunch of medication. And that's how the government helped me. I went to therapy sessions. And what they did was they had me see a new therapist every week. Each time I went in, you had a new person each time, basically trying to get my story down. And I would say 80% of them had adequate credentials. There was one guy who had a degree in religion from the University of Phoenix. I mean, it's an online degree. It's not real. So, I mean, there's not a lot of, research into these people before they put them out as social workers. And there is a shortage of psychologists. But, I mean, I would say it's a lot better now than it was. I have to give them credit. But the cognitive behavioral therapy, I don't think, is a really adequate way of addressing it. I don't know what it's like in Australia, but I know in Great Britain, it's less effective than that. I mean, sometimes people don't even get the medication they need.
Okay, let's go to other questions. Where's the microphone down there? Go ahead.
Question. Yep. I'd like to ask, why is it we have a plebiscite about gay marriage, yet we don't have plebiscites for other issues? Why is it we don't get more of a say in what governments do? Because a lot of what you do is not what a lot of us agree with. Say, why can't we have a plebiscite to save the Great Barrier Reef, of which we're putting in $1 billion when we need $20 billion to save it? Why can't we have more say in other things?
Okay. We'll go to Andrew and Sarah on that, and or Teri if she
wants
actually,
to. Well, actually,
can
ahead. I go pee?
Yeah, you can go first. And what
no,
I'm just going to say...
Can I go pee? I've had two children.
Oh, sorry. Can I go pee? Sorry, I thought you said, can I go first? Of course you can go pee. I'm going to just we're going to go for another 7 minutes till 4:15, just to let you know. Go ahead.
Just keeping it short, we should have more plebiscites. A, they're expensive. B, we need electronic voting to make them even more effective. But yeah, for too long we've had remote politics.
I think what would be good is to see politicians actually be honest with people during election campaign about what they're going to do and what they want to do.
Well, we just saw Teri was very honest about what she wanted to do.
That's true. I'm not sure. I'm not sure how that polled in the electorate, but I understand the point that you make, but the reality is we live in a representative democracy, and as politicians, we are put there to represent the views of the community, to have these debates, to continue that conversation with you. It's not just about winning an election and then spending the next 3 years trying to work out how we win the next one. We actually have to govern, debate things, and continue that conversation over those 3 years with the public. And if we did that, and if we had a bit more honesty and a bit more engagement from politicians with the public, then I don't think you'd be asking that question. The other thing we have to get rid of is actually the vested interests in all of this. And when you talk about things like the Great Barrier Reef, you talk about tackling climate change, we have to get rid of those massive election donations to political parties that are skewing what is then done or not done in the name of progress, in the name of policy.
Correct me if I'm wrong, that's something that Andrew agreed with earlier, is that right?
It was.
Do you want to just jump in, Andrew? Do you want to...
Just on, got a record, I'll do it again.
Just on that point.
There's plenty of public debate at the moment about individual donation, by capping individual donation, removing union and corporate donation. Anything that's indirect donating is a worry, where you know exactly who gives the money, how much, what it's spent on. Well, hey, you're never going to ban donations, right? Otherwise, just millionaires run for politics and they fund themselves. We don't want that. So ultimately, you want to know who's moving the money and why.
Okay, I'm going to go to... There's a gentleman with a beard right there. We'll give you the question. We'll try and get short answers and we'll get a few questions still.
Hi. Drugs have been a significant talk of discussion in the lead-up to this festival.
You say drugs?
Drugs.
Okay, gotcha.
I'm 35 years old. I have watched drugs evolve for the 3.5 decades I've been alive, but the message has always been the same from all the authorities: drugs are bad. Now, drugs will evolve through this. As a father, I'm terrified of what that could actually mean in 10, 20 years' time when my child is old enough to come to these festivals. Why hasn't anyone changed the message? Why has harm minimalization not been implemented? And why are we not having a conversation about it at all?
Okay, Teri, bring you in on that, and I'll get to Andrew.
Look, I think that's a really good question, because we do talk about what needs to happen in relation to the way that this nation responds to drugs. It's been a feature of... I've been in the Parliament for 2.5 years, and I have to say most of the discussion has been about medicinal marijuana and how to make that opened up to people with terminal illnesses.
And that is fantastic.
But I know it's not the point you're making. But I've got to say, when you talk about this, the reason that an aspect of an issue starts to take hold is because I think it's fair to say that our political process is a big machine with many gears that grind slowly. And so to build a consensus and to get an aggregation of enough agreement to actually make change is something that is incredibly difficult. So with any social issue or economic issue for that matter, I think building the groundswell of support is what is needed to get change. And you can see the issues, they're really obvious where that has happened, and you can also obviously see the ones where that hasn't. So from my view, to be honest, sure. Tony, from my perspective, I would love to see our nation change the way that it responds to drugs, because I'm a parent too, and I don't want my kids to be let down by a system that has so far not been able to deal with some of the consequences of drugs.
When you say change, do you mean decriminalisation? He mentioned harm minimalisation. Are you talking about decriminalisation?
Oh, well, look, I think that when it comes to... I mean, obviously, I think you have to be... It's a bit easy to give a simple answer when, in fact, it's a very complicated issue. But my own perspective is finding ways to deal with the supply chain, which is what people try to do, but also not criminalising young people and criminalising behaviour is really important, because people don't need to have the disadvantage throughout their whole life that criminalisation can bring.
Okay, Peter, and we'll keep the answers brief, because there's still a couple of... We're probably going to have to stop soon, right? Okay.
Very briefly. I mean, I've watched the way that the drugs war works at the other end in places like Colombia. It seems to me incredibly frustrating that we still treat it as a criminal problem and not a medical one. The sooner we can get the discussion about drugs around the medical issues, the sooner we can decriminalise it, the sooner we'll deal not just with the health issues, but we'll also deal with crime.
Andrew.
Just some technology. We are 1 year away from a handheld illicit drug test being manufactured at Oxford University at a music festival. If you show any signs of unusual or antisocial behaviour, are you prepared to be tested on the spot? Suncorp Stadium. If you're turning up in a stadium, we could be tested within 2 years. a safe night out drink precinct? Do you want to have people tested on the footpath if you're not listening to police? If you work for immigration, and alcohol first and then illicit drugs. And then finally, the big one, if you're a welfare recipient, 100% of your income is coming from welfare. You're not turning up to your job interviews, work experience or work for the dole. Should you be illicit drug tested? A big moral question.
Just can we hear your big moral answer?
I think it's a great debate. I don't have a position yet, but I'll have a look. You need to know, state agencies will be holding this technology within 2 years.
No, we shouldn't be drug testing people who require the assistance of the state for social security, no.
If you're not adhering to your requirements under the same laws that are paying your income, potentially that will be the debate.
Just
be ready for
it. It's just more demonisation of people as from the Tories.
You know what, I've been thinking about this for a little while. I think we need to put breath testing actually on our the chamber doors before MPs walk into the chamber. I wouldn't even, if there's an instant, you know, illicit drug test there, Andrew, we might need to implement that too, but definitely breath testing, I think, for alcohol. I think the broader issue is this harm minimisation. All of the experts, all of the medical experts, all of the law enforcement experts actually are crying out for government and for decision makers to take the courage to say, okay, yes, we will start looking at this not as an issue of criminalisation, not as an issue of young people being wrong because they're taking drugs, looking at it from a health perspective. And we have to... It takes political courage to do that. But I think the Parliament and politicians, we are so much further behind public, the public's view on this. And also, it's getting to a point now where if it doesn't happen... we're going to start to feel it at the ballot box, I believe.
And guys, I'm really sorry, but we are going to have to call it quits now. I want to thank you for your incredible engagement with the panel. I'm sorry we couldn't get to every question, but we'd just like to thank our panel at the end, though. Sarah Hanson-Young, Teri Butler, Andrew Lamming, Peter Greste on this side, and Sean Westmoreland. Thank you very much. And thanks to you as an audience, you've been fantastic. I don't mind a bit of booing. I don't mind a bit of cheering. You're great.